Thank you for tuning in to the Andrew Tate Show by GSMC Sports. I am your co-host, Sarah. Joining me, as always, is Tate, and we have a great show planned for you today. We will be talking about why Paul George left the Clippers, Steph Curry's feelings about Klay Thompson's departure, Stephen A. Smith's potential departure from ESPN, Will Smith's chances of his Oscar ban being lifted, and stick around for segment 5 when we will be talking about the Paris Olympics trying to be the greenest Olympics ever, but encountering some snags. As we get started, I do want to remind you to like and follow the show. That really does help us out. As we get started, a reminder that you can go to dsmcpodcast.net and leave a tip or a donation. That is a really good way to help out not only the show, but the entire network. If you want to leave a question or a comment at that time, that's going to come up at the top of our list, ensuring that we see it. We do get a lot of questions and comments. So if you go to gsmcpodcast.net, you can leave a question or comment. You can leave a tip or a donation. Thank you, as always, for any support that you give. Tate, hello.
Hello, Miss Sarah. Look like, okay, we're out for a little bit, for a little sabbatical, and you've got how the system work look like.
just getting my muscle memory back.
I looked at what you're about to push. I'm like, oh no, that's not right.
We're making it work.
All right.
We are making it work.
That is just funny there.
Why don't we go ahead and jump into it?
But are you happy to be back? We've been gone for a few weeks.
And yes, I was going to say, it's nice to be hanging out with you again. I was kind of smiling during my intro because there's a lot of departures and leavings and possible leavings and maybe coming backs in our stories for today. So
Paul George departs. Klay Thompson departs. Stephen A. Smith could depart.
Will Smith banned from the Oscars. That's a departure of a kind.
Well, I was just going to say he departed that hand from Chris Rock. That was a long time ago. That's some time ago. But we may have an arrival there, so it's going to be interesting.
Yeah, it will be interesting. Well, we'll get to that in a little bit, but let's go ahead and start with our first story of the day, and this one is about Paul George and his departure from the Clippers. He recently revealed on his podcast, Podcast P with Paul George, that he never intended to leave Los Angeles, but felt disrespected by the Clippers' initial contract offer. George, who has since signed a 4-year, $212 million max deal with the Philadelphia 76ers, was open to staying with the Clippers for a 3-year, $150 million extension, similar to what Kawhi Leonard received, but with a no-trade clause. However, the Clippers were unwilling to meet these terms. George explained that the Clippers' first offer was a 2-year, $60 million deal, which he found unacceptable. Despite his desire to stay in LA and win a championship there, the negotiations were challenging. The Clippers cited the new collective bargaining agreement constraints as a reason for their conservative approach to roster building and salary offers. The situation became even more complex when the Clippers secured Leonard's 3-year, $150 million extension, prompting George to request the same. Despite his willingness to match Leonard's terms, including taking less than the max contract, the Clippers only marginally increased their offer to around $44 to $45 million per year. This led George to feel undervalued, especially after learning about Leonard's contract. The Clippers management stated that they wanted to retain their star players, including George, Leonard, and James Harden, while navigating the restrictive new CBA. However, negotiations with George did not progress significantly, leading to a significant gap in their offers and expectations. George detailed how these discussions took place before the All-Star break and how he chose to pause negotiations to avoid affecting his performance. Eventually, as free agency loomed, the Clippers were willing to offer George a deal similar to Leonard's, but without the no-trade clause. George then asked for a 4-year, $212 million deal to ensure security in case of a future trade. Before making his final decision, George consulted Leonard, who supported his choice to move to Philadelphia. Despite their close relationship and shared goals, the pair's tenure with the Clippers was marred by injuries, limiting their success to just one Western Conference Finals appearance in 5 seasons. George expressed his disappointment but acknowledged the business aspect of the sport, ultimately deciding it was time to move on. George concluded by expressing his appreciation for the Clippers owners Steve Ballmer and President Lawrence Frank, that admitted that returning under the circumstances wouldn't have felt right. All right, Tate, I know you have thoughts.
Okay. First, I think when all this went down, initially, I was a little surprised. I'm like, wow, I can't believe that the Clippers let him slip through the fingers. But as I listen to this more and more, I'm realizing I don't know if the Clippers really wanted him.
Mm-hmm. Say more.
He is clearly their... Kawhi Leonard is their 1A. He's their 1B. The Clippers were going to go as far as Kawhi Leonard and Paul George took them. You know, he was Batman. Kawhi Leonard's Batman. He's Robin. I guess that makes James Harden Batgirl. I don't know what it makes him, James Harden. But those were the two stars. And I start thinking about nothing. Like, Paul George talks about feeling disrespected. And sometimes I hear players, NFL and NBA players, talk about feeling disrespected by the millions of dollars that are offered them. And you're kind of taken back, like, come on, dude. You know. But in this particular case, I agree with Paul George. If you get to the point where it's your time for renewing your contract and you're eligible for $212 million, your team knows you're eligible for $212 million. And, you know, they know that you're going to be a desired piece out on free agency. And you only offer them $60 million is nuts. I would have, the $60 million, I would have looked at them like, wait a minute, are you serious? Like, what do you mean $60 million? If they just came out, and I don't understand why, if they really wanted them to be together and to stay on the Clippers, for him, they decided to hold off on negotiating with him. And then they took care of Kawhi Leonard, who was eligible for that same amount of money. But Kawhi Leonard took less year, and I think about $8, $9 million less. So $150 million is what he signed. Paul George said he would have taken that. My question to the Clippers or anyone else is, if I have my two superstars, and their contracts are both coming up due at the same time, and I want them to take less years, I don't understand why they didn't bring them into the meeting together and be like, listen, we really want you two to stay together. We want you to be Clippers for life. We have this problem with the new CBA and the second apron. Can we work together to find a happy medium that both of you guys will be happy? That's what a good organization will do. A good organization doesn't say, hey, we really want Kawhi Leonard, so $150 for you and then $60 million for Paul George. I would have felt some kind of way. Then for George to come back to them and say, once he learned what Kawhi Leonard got, to come to them and say, listen, I'm willing to forgo the $212 million. I want to stay in Los Angeles. I'm willing to take the exact same deal that Kawhi Leonard has, but I want a no trade clause. Because if I'm going to take, you know, $62 million less than I'm eligible to get, I don't want to be traded away. Kind of the way Blake Griffin did. And the reason why I say that is Blake Griffin, they told him how they wanted him to be a Clipper for life and all this. And Blake Griffin decided to sign with the Clippers. He was their franchise player. He decided to do a team friendly deal. He signed that deal. It was 4 to 6 months later they shipped him off. Knowing that history, why, if I'm Paul George, knowing that history, I'm not taking less unless I do get that no trade clause. That's the one thing that protects me from you doing me the way Paul George is. I mean, not Paul George, but Blake Griffin. I don't think anything that Paul George requested was like extreme, out of the ordinary, unprecedented. There was a history there. There was some negotiations that wasn't done really in good faith. When you're offering a guy that's due $212 million and you say, we'll give you $60, take your paycheck and cut it by 70%. And you tell your boss, hey, I really want to stay there. And they're like, yeah, we'll bring you back, but we're going to cut your check by 70%. You wouldn't be happy. So, and honestly, I feel like this move, because of this, the hard feelings that came on with this, it was the right move for Paul George to leave. But it also ended, in my opinion, any shot of the Clippers getting a championship. Second thing is, when I sit there and I say, I want to go to Los Angeles, and you look at what the Lakers did for Kobe at the end of his career, making sure he was taken care of with his last big contract. LeBron, 40 years old, and what the Lakers have just done with LeBron. The Lakers have a history of taking care of their own people. And you look at the Clippers, what they did to Blake Griffin, and now what is coming out with Paul George. If you're a free agent, do you really, which one, and you want to go to Los Angeles, I think the Lakers are a much better option. I think it really does hurt them. What do you think, Sarah?
I think there's always about 10 sides to every story, and we're never going to get more than I'm sure there's a ton of conversations that go on, but from an outsider looking in, that's just, as a person that wouldn't know how to negotiate myself in any sports. I don't have any experience, but I would get this and say, I would not take it. I would not encourage another person to take it. I mean, I feel the disrespect.
You're talking about, I'm eligible for $212 million and they only offer you $60. That makes it so that I don't know I don't know if they really value me. Then to turn around and then they give Kawhi Leonard a contract, you want to take the same deal, but you want a no trade clause because you're taking such a big pay cut, and they're still not willing to do it. Oh no, and you got the Philadelphia 76ers and other teams like, listen, we are ready to give you all 4 years. We're not shortchanging you on the years. We're going to give you the maximum dollars and the maximum years. And you have a company over here and another, your current organization saying, we don't want to give you the max years. We don't want to give you the max money. We don't even want to make you equal to your cohort and make sure you guys are on the same playing field. Same pay field. They're saying no, no, no. That is three strikes. Paul George is out. Only bad thing I see is it's going to be weird. Paul George, I think he's going to be number 8 now. So no more PG-13. That's his whole brand. And that's a weird one that is going to, he's going to lose the PG-13. He's going to be PG-8.
That sounds more like a Star Wars.
It sounds like a golf tournament, a golf organization. Instead of PGA to PG-8. So
I'm sure they can make some clever play on words.
Yeah, they'll figure it out. But yeah, that's
13 is a good one. That is clever.
So the greatest one was Andrei Kirilenko from Russia, AK-47. That's the best nickname ever.
It's a good note to go to our first break on. So we are going to take that first break. When we come back, we'll be talking about Klay Thompson's departure and Steph Curry's feelings about that departure. You are tuned into the Andrew Tate Show by GSMC Sports, and we will be right back.
I feel like I'm losing my mind. Is everybody in the world blind? Please, Lord, give me a sign, a sign. I feel like I'm losing my mind.
be the greatest. Everybody on the fake shit. I look around and feel like everybody is the fakest. I make this every day and I'm impatient, hoping one day I blow up from the basement. Statement, the top is so vacant. I don't hear shit that I think is amazing. Waiting for my day when I'm playing sold out shows for 1,000 faces. Hey, give me that crown. Get in my way and to be put down. It ain't your place, no, this my town. If I want that shit, then I'll get it right now. I'm losing it, the noose, it fits some loose shit, a stupid myth. You choose to live or choose to dip. You choose to fight or lose your grip and lose a gift. Oh.
I feel like I'm losing my mind. Is everybody in the world blind? Please, Lord, give me a sign, a sign. I feel like I'm losing my mind. Is everybody in the world blind?
Welcome back to the Andrew Tate Show by GSMC Sports. In the first segment, we were talking about Paul George. I'm trying to say Clay Thompson and Paul George and everybody together, and it just came out wrong. We were talking about Paul George's departure from the Los Angeles Clippers. We are moving into our second segment, but as we get into that segment, I do want to remind you once again that if you want to go to gsmcpodcast.net, you can leave a tip or a donation. That will ensure that your question or comment gets put at the top of our list, ensuring that we see it. We do like engaging with those questions during the show. So please go to gsmcpodcast.net. You can leave a tip or a donation. And now we are moving into our second departure story for the day. Give me 1 second. And after 13 remarkable seasons with the Golden State Warriors, Klay Thompson's tenure has come to an end as he moves to the Dallas Mavericks. The departure has left a significant impact on his former teammates, particularly Draymond Green and Stephen Curry. Curry expressed his deep sense of loss and adjustment during an interview, highlighting the bond and history they shared. Thompson and Curry, known as the Splash Brothers, revolutionized the game with their unparalleled three-point shooting. Their synergy on the court led to an astonishing 678 combined three-pointers in the 2015-16 season, and together they secured 4 NBA titles for the Warriors. Their partnership since 2011 set new benchmarks for the league, making them one of the most iconic duos in NBA history. The separation between Thompson and the Warriors was unforeseen. The situation escalated dramatically when Thompson unfollowed the team on Instagram, signaling a rift during contract negotiations. Steph Curry, in an interview with NBA.com, shared his perspective on the split, emphasizing that Thompson needed a change. Curry acknowledged the emotional difficulty of parting ways, but supported Thompson's decision for his personal and professional well-being. Curry expressed that despite the sadness of no longer playing together, he respects Thompson's choice and wishes him happiness in his new chapter with the Mavericks. The mutual respect and understanding between the two players underscore the strong bond they share, even as their professional paths diverge. Curry's reflections on the end of the Splash Brothers era are filled with nostalgia and respect. He hopes that Thompson finds joy and success in Dallas while he and the Warriors adjust to a new chapter without one of their key players. The end of their partnership marks the conclusion of a significant era in Golden State Warriors history, but their contributions to the game and the memories they've created will endure. Tate, definitely the end of an era.
Absolutely.
Endings are always difficult. Transitions are always difficult. But when you've got this much history and this kind of connection, it can't be easy.
You know, for us, you know, our main office is in California. And GSMC stands for Golden State Media Concept. So we're from, you know, our office headquarters spend a lot of time in that Bay Area, you know. So Stephen Clay, Draymond is like an institution in Northern California. So the fact that they're splitting up is, it's just hard to believe. You know, you always thought those three would always, they would finish their career as Warriors. Now, that sounds kind of funny, as Warriors.
We know what you mean.
But when I look at this, I truly feel like this was the right move for Clay. I'm going to go back a little bit because I haven't talked about why I think it's a good move or talked about it since we've been out. But Clay was at the peak of his powers. They're Splash Brothers. They're doing amazing. And then he hurts his, I believe it was his knee. And then right after that, he blows out his Achilles. So recovering from something like that, it's not, most people think it's a year. You're out of season and you're back. No. It sometimes takes a couple years to come back. But as an athlete, you don't have a couple of years. You got months to come back. And I felt like Clay was trying to come back, but also get back to where he was at. And you got to find your new normal. And when I watched Clay the last year or so, last 2 years or so with the Warriors, I always looked at Clay as he's going to need two and a half years or so, which no one's going to give you sympathy on that, but he's going to need that much time to come back. But then when I watch him on the court, a lot of times I'm like, Clay has lost his confidence. He doesn't have the same swag on the court like he used to, you know, and you know, you have to have, if to be a top-notch player, you know, you have to be mentally there. And I never thought Clay was mentally there. One, where is he worried about the injuries. Two, he's worried about, is he still old Clay Thompson? Then he's also knowing he's an older player coming up on this contract. Is it over for him? And still not playing well, but finishing nicely toward the end of the last year. He was starting to finish nicely. But ultimately, when you're in that position, you're trying to get yourself back, you also know, hey, not only have I lost confidence, but you can see your teammates in the organization mostly, you can tell the way they act, that they've lost confidence in Clay. They were quick to re-sign everyone but Clay. It was you know, you start feeling that, and instantly, once you have that feeling that you're not yourself and you're trying to find yourself, you're not the same teammate to your old players that you've grown up with, and the organization is looking at you different, it's almost impossible to get all that. It is impossible. So a lot of times, in order for him to come back, a player to come back to even resemble anything what they used to be, a fresh start is needed. And so I thought this was the right decision for Clay. Going somewhere where there's already an established superstar in Luka, an established point guard in Kyrie, you know, and then adding him, he's a great piece for the Mavericks. And it gives him a fresh start where he's going to walk in that door and everyone is going to be excited that you're here. It's not like, oh, okay, yeah, that's Clay's here. He's not the same guy he used to be, but he's still part. He's a member of the family. It's a big difference then. You're the piece, when you walk in that door, you're the piece where we were missing last year. If we would have had you last year, we would have won a championship. You got experience, you're a champion, you're experienced, you're a clutch player, you're a great shooter, you're just what we need. That's a whole different view. Now, people are looking at you on a different level. So your confidence goes up. The organization is excited to have you. So your confidence goes up even more. Your new teammates are excited to have you. It's a better situation. What's best for Clay is this move right here. I don't think, even if Clay got back to 70, 80% of what he used to be, but in Golden State, everyone would look at him as, you're still not Clay the Splash Brother. The organization, he's a diminishing asset. You going to a new team, you're not a diminishing asset. You are a great addition to our goal. you look at your teammates and you're that injection of energy we needed. You're now the energy instead of the reason why we are not performing well. It's a whole different move. Now, talking about Steph and Clay, like I said, it's gonna be an adjustment, Buddy. For Golden State going out and getting Buddy Hield. Buddy Hield's no Clay Thompson, even right now. I'm sorry, I'd take an old Clay over Buddy Hield. I don't think Golden State is better today than they were a couple of weeks ago when Clay left. But with that being said, I personally think if I was Golden State, it's time, with Clay leaving, maybe it's time to revamp that team. You have, and maybe go make one more run where you have Steph Curry as your focal point and put around players that complement Steph. Because, you know, trying to recreate the Splash Brothers, it can't be done. That team is a once in a lifetime team. Draymond is older. Has gotten in a lot of trouble. Draymond's one incident from being suspended indefinitely. Clay is gone. It is best to circle the wagons and re-up and try to figure out how to make another run with Steph. You can do that. Steph is such a viable piece that you can still make a run with him, but you cannot. If Golden State is thinking they're going to go in and recreate the Splash Brothers, the time has passed. So
that's the thing with anything iconic like that. You can never fully replicate it.
Yeah, no.
You shouldn't try because you're just trying to recreate the wheel. I mean,
yeah, no.
You have to do something new, something that is maybe just as impressive, but not the same thing, because it's never going to be the same.
Because they still have Steph. And so I would be building, I would tear that down and kind of reorganize a team strictly with Steph and taking advantage of his abilities and not even attempt to go with the whole Splash Brothers thing. I don't know if Buddy Hield's really that viable of a piece to be added. It doesn't change their playoff contention. I give them less than a 1% chance of being in a playoff contender. I don't even see them as a play-in team. So that's kind of where I see them at. But I definitely see Dallas as a much stronger team. So.
Well, it could potentially be exciting to create something new.
Yes.
At Golden State, we'll just have to wait and see. Let's go ahead and take our second break of this episode. When we come back, talking about not necessarily a departure, but maybe potential. We're talking about Stephen A. Smith's future with ESPN. You are tuned in to the Andrew Tate Show by GSMC Sports, and we will be right back.
Looking for your daily fix of sports talk without having to pay for it? GSMC Sports Network is available on YouTube. Just search GSMC Sports Network. Get your fix of daily sports talk shows on YouTube. Absolutely free. NFL, college football, NBA, MLB, MMA, UFC, fantasy football, and so much more. GSMC Sports Network has shows running all day long, with new sports shows starting every 2 hours. Just like on your favorite cable sports channel, except GSMC Sports Network is absolutely free. Just search GSMC Sports Network on YouTube to catch one of your new favorite shows, like the GSMC College Football Podcast, Chip Shot Football Podcast, Hoops and Heels Women's Sports Podcast, GSMC Basketball Podcast, and so many more. Check it out for yourself. GSMC Sports Network, now available on YouTube, absolutely free.
Welcome back to the Andrew Tate Show by GSMC Sports. In the first segment, we talked about Paul George's departure from the Clippers. Last segment, segment two, we talked about Klay Thompson's departure from Golden State Warriors and Steph Curry's feelings about that departure. As we get into segment three, we are switching gears, talking about ESPN and Stephen A. Smith. Let me just get this set up quickly. Stephen A. Smith and ESPN have yet to reach an agreement on a new contract, leaving the future of one of sports television's most dynamic personalities uncertain. Smith, whose contract expires in 2025, is seeking $25 million annually. The network and Smith have exchanged figures but remain far apart in negotiations, with Smith willing to move to another network if his demands are not met. This potential departure has sparked speculation about who might replace Smith on ESPN's flagship show First Take. Several prominent names have surfaced as potential successors. First, Shannon Sharpe. As the leading candidate, Sharpe has become a fan favorite and has significant experience on First Take alongside Molly Caro and other guests. His recent contract extension with ESPN ensures his presence for the foreseeable future, making him a stable option during the transition. Another option is Ryan Clark, who is another top talent at ESPN. Clark has also worked on First Take. Though less animated than Stephen A. or Sharpe, Clark's insightful commentary and versatility across the various ESPN programs make him a strong contender. Someone else to consider, Shaquille O'Neal. With his contract for Inside the NBA expiring simultaneously with Smith, Shaq could be a major acquisition for ESPN. His larger-than-life personality and widespread appeal would bring a new dynamic to First Take. Or Pat McAfee. Already one of ESPN's highest-paid talents, McAfee's move to First Take would be seamless in terms of star power. However, balancing this role with his existing commitments to The Pat McAfee Show could be challenging. Another option, Jason Kelce. A wild card pick, Kelce's involvement in Monday Night Football could expand if he performs well. Additionally, his connection to the Swifty demographic could attract a broader audience to ESPN's programming. The uncertainty surrounding Stephen A. Smith's future at ESPN underscores the network's need to plan for a potential shift in its programming landscape. The possible replacements each bring unique strengths to the table, but none may perfectly replicate the energy and influence Smith commands. As negotiations continue, ESPN faces a critical juncture in maintaining its dominance in sports media. So, Tate, two things. First, your thoughts on the negotiations, the contract negotiations, and then if Stephen A. Smith does leave, your thoughts on who could be a potential replacement.
Oh, I already have. I already have the replacement. I have the replacement, and it's not me. Okay, I got the perfect replacement. We're gonna save that for last. Okay, first off,
go in the order of the questions I gave you.
I'm gonna go a little bit different, and I'll go to your question.
Okay, fine. Do your thing.
First, when you look at a lot of people, think about what people get paid when they work at ESPN. The average person at ESPN makes anywhere from, let's say, $30,000 to $200,000 a year. That's about what the average person gets. Stephen A. Smith, Pat McAfee, Mike Greenberg, those are the cream of the crop. That's the top of the food chain. Those guys get millions. But most people do not make the money that people think they make there. Then you take into account ESPN for the last decade has been shedding a lot of personalities. So much so that ESPN has kind of become a network where it's the same people doing the same stories over and over and over again, it feels like. And the media world has changed a lot, partially because of ESPN releasing a lot of people. So there's this whole world of new media, as Draymond called it, and I think it's a perfect name for it. Companies like GSMC, which you're watching us at. There's Locked On Sports. There's A Volume with Colin Cowherd. There's Barstool Sports. Then you have independent shows like Marcellus Wiley. Shaq has his own show, Club Shay Shay. The media world has changed. From everything I have seen, ESPN came to Stephen A. Smith and they offered $18 million a season. This is what I'm seeing. I don't know. I'm just doing from what my research has. It could be off. I'm not in negotiations, but this is what I've been seeing. They offered him $18 million a season for, I think it was 4 years. And Stephen A. Smith said no. He wants to be the highest paid guy in media, and he wanted $25 million a year. Like I said, this is from what I'm seeing. I'm not in those meetings. But when you start thinking about what the average person at ESPN makes, and I'm not throwing no shade at Stephen A. Smith. You can get it, brother. Go get it. More power to you. I wish I could go and get asked for $25 million a year. Can't do that. But when you're starting to look at, with the rise of all this new media that's coming out and things, and I feel like ESPN seems like it's getting smaller and smaller, where it's the same group of guys on all the same shows anymore. If they don't go the route of bringing back Stephen A. Smith, I would love to see them open it back up so there's a lot more talent, so you're not seeing the same guys on every single show over and over again, because it draws you away from ESPN where it used to be. Now, your question is, let's say Stephen A. Smith does go, and I know he has his Stephen A. Smith show, which he owns, and I'm sure Fox Sports and a lot of other networks would be clamoring to get him. So let's say Stephen A. Smith decides to part ways, and ESPN is looking at Shaq, or first off,
I'm coming back in so I can see.
Yes, it. Okay. First off,
I hear your choice.
I love Helen Molly. I love Shannon Sharp. I think those are perfect. Those two. You already have them. You don't have to make that move. I leave Ryan Clark right where he's at, where he comes in as a guest. Shaq is great, but not that kind of that. He's not that kind of a on-air personality to me. He's fun, but every day for 4 hours a day, I don't know how that really fits. And so they went down. Pat McAfee's doing his own thing, his own show. He owns all of it.
I don't know when he sleeps either.
Right. Not sure. And he's doing WWE on for Monday Night Raw. He's doing College Game Day. Pat McAfee's living his best life and has, I don't think, would have much interest in going there. So I take him out. One or both of the Kelce brothers. Interesting, but I don't know how much. They're entertaining, but I'm talking about the debate desk, more animated people. So I'm going to give you who I think would be. Who else doesn't own that list before I go to mine?
I think you covered them. Give me just a second. So Jason Kelce, Pat McAfee, Ryan Clark, Shannon Sharp. Yeah, you covered.
Okay.
Shaq.
Now, how would you like this? You got Molly as the moderator. Works perfect. You got Shannon Sharp still staying in his role, but he's more taking the lead role like Stephen A. Smith. And across from Shannon Sharp,
you're just milking this.
Charles Barkley.
Okay.
Charles Barkley would be perfect for it. He's a no-nonsense guy. He's not a corporate guy. He's going to say what's on his mind. Two guys from the South, very different personalities. You got a former NBA great. You got a former NFL great. Charles is pure entertainment on the mic, even on the show that he does now. I know Charles said once inside the NFL, meaning the NBA is over, that he's going to retire. But I remember when Charles said he was retiring when he was a basketball player. Charles threatened to retire like 4 or 5 times. Don't mean you can get that Charles is going to retire. I love putting Charles Barkley and Shannon together, I think would be really good. Shaq and Shannon, they've had a little bit of a beef even lately. That has come up. So,
Shaq and Shannon is really good alliteration. I'll give them that.
Yeah, but now there's already been some butting heads there. I don't know how well that would work, especially when you look at how Shannon Sharp and Skip Bayless kind of butted heads, and it became a very tenuous situation, let's just say. Bringing in Shaq, just I don't think that's a good fit. But bringing in Charles Barkley, I think would be perfect. You know, it lends a lot of credibility on the basketball side. You know, you can't argue and say you guys don't know what you're talking about. Listen, Charles is one of the greatest basketball players to ever play the game, football. Shannon Sharp is one of the greatest players to ever play the game at tight end. You put them together with their unique personalities, with the stories that you have there. Now you're bringing, and then you with the unique crazy comments that Shaq hits out. I mean, not Shaq, but Charles Barkley kicks out. That is gold. And Molly is the traffic cop who just kind of keeps things going.
She sometimes has trouble maintaining control of the people she's got. It's gonna be a completely different dynamic.
Yes, it's a very different dynamic because you don't want to have somebody else come in who's loud and yelling and all this stuff, because that's what Stephen A. Smith did. And so it's kind of like you're just trying to reinvent and bring in your next Stephen A. Smith. It doesn't work. But Charles Barkley is his own man, his own personality. Charles Barkley is an American icon and a controversial figure all rolled into one. You're not going to sure what you're going to get. You're going to have unique takes that Shannon is not going to have. These guys will have very different views, but could build a nice rapport together. I could see Charles working well with Molly. Shannon already works well with Molly. I think that would be the perfect fit if Stephen A. Smith decided to leave. I wish you the best on getting that. If you get that 25, my man, woo, impress.
Well, as with all many things, we will keep an eye on it, and I'm sure we'll be talking more about it, regardless of whether he gets the contract, he doesn't get the contract. If they're bringing in a replacement, there's going to be stuff to talk about it. So let's go ahead and take our next break. When we come back, switching from sports to entertainment, we'll be talking about Will Smith and that 10-year Oscar ban. Is he able to come back earlier than that? You are tuned in to the Andrew Tate Show by GSMC Sports, and we will be right back.
For the best and latest podcasts available anywhere, go to the podcast app on your cell phone and type in GSMC to access free content-rich podcasts on health and wellness, book reviews, sports, entertainment, relationships, social media, movies, technology, finance, and even weird news. Subscribe and download the GSMC Podcast Network's family of shows. Available everywhere podcasts are found.
Welcome back to the Andrew Tate Show by GSMC Sports. In the first segment, we talked about, I always want to say George Paul. Paul George. I just need a big, big note. Paul George's departure from the LA.
George Paul. I'm like, it's George Paul.
It's all Beatles names. I get them confused. Segment two, we talked about Klay Thompson's departure from the Golden State Warriors. And in segment three, our previous segment, we talked about Stephen A. Smith's negotiations, his contract negotiations, possibly, potentially leaving ESPN and who could replace him on First Take. As I said, we are now moving into entertainment news with Will Smith, who's back in the media again, of course, with the premiere of Bad Boys 4. We are seeing a lot of him now. Tate, I know you want to see that movie, but we have seen a lot of trailers for it. At any rate, Will Smith's career is currently under scrutiny following the infamous altercation with Chris Rock at the Oscars, which resulted in a 10-year ban from the Academy Awards. Despite recent box office successes, including Bad Boys 4, Smith's journey back to the Oscars remains uncertain. The Academy's decision hinges on Smith's ability to demonstrate genuine remorse for his actions and maintain exemplary behavior moving forward. Paul N.J. Otteson, a respected sound designer and three-time Oscar winner, offered insights into Smith's situation. Otteson believes in the importance of forgiveness, but supports the Academy's decision to uphold the ban as a consequence for Smith's behavior. He emphasized that Smith must earn his way back through continued acclaim and sincere contrition. Reflecting on Smith's career, Otteson acknowledged his significant evolution from his days as a 90s box office star to his recent roles, notably praising his performance in King Richard. He highlighted Smith's maturity as an actor and as a person, suggesting that life experiences have shaped his growth and perspective. At the premiere of Protocol 7, where Otteson shared his views, he discussed the complexities of forgiveness and redemption in Hollywood, paralleling them with controversial figures like Andrew Wakefield. Otteson expressed the view that art should provoke discussion and that truths, even uncomfortable ones, deserve to be acknowledged. So, I actually don't fully know who Otteson is, but he has thoughts.
Okay.
And lots of people have thoughts. So, yeah, everyone has thoughts. I know you have thoughts. Let's talk about thoughts.
First off, he mentioned, you know, more of Will Smith showing that he was sorry for what he's done. I think Will Smith has gone out of his way to show you that was a bad moment, and you know he was sorry and should not have done this and that. And then the whole thing about showing good behavior and things. With the exception of, you know, the pimp slap heard around the world. With the exception of that slap heard around the world, Will Smith has never done anything bad. So when you look at it and say, is there any guy that deserves a second chance more than Will Smith? He's been a model citizen his whole career. You look at some of the people in Hollywood, in the music industry, and some of the things that they have gotten in trouble with, from Robert Downey Jr. Look at his past. Look at, you know, Mel Gibson. There's so many actors and actresses that have gotten into way more trouble than a guy getting upset and trying to defend his wife and having a slight moment of bad judgment. Granted, you don't normally see that on TV live, but it happens. I'm sorry. I think that tenure ban should be lifted. He immediately has apologized to Chris Rock. Chris Rock has never really accepted the apology. And I can understand that. If he walked up on stage and slapped me like that, I would never forgive him either.
So you don't want me to just come up to you and slap you in the middle of a segment?
Oh, shoo! I'm telling you this right now. I'm just hashing this out. Me and Will have been rolling on this off that stage together. I'm just saying, but he deserves that. And deserves a second chance. Secondly, we're in Portugal. So to show you the magnitude of how big this was, the very next day, I mean, that night it happened, it was everywhere around Portugal and Spain. Before, like, everywhere. Everyone was talking about it. I remember it's the equivalent of, I think it was the equivalent of the DMV I had to go to. And I'm there and the ladies are talking about it. You know, they're talking about the slap and it's just like, oh my goodness. And I'm shocked that people knew about this big incident. So this was not just a US-based incident. This, when I call it the slap heard around the world, we are based in Portugal, in the southern part of Portugal, and everyone knew about it. So it's on a, if you're gonna slap someone, slap them on a global scale. You know what I mean? I mean, he really, only thing he was missing was a little talcum, a little baby powder or something like that. You know, a little baby powder on there. That was the only thing that was missing.
Clearly, it wasn't premeditated.
Oh, yes. If he'd have walked up on stage with some baby powder.
I'm intrigued by the 10-year ban because there really isn't a precedent. We've never had, you know, kind of this public level of craziness at the Oscars, right? So yes, actions need to have consequences. I'm curious what went into those conversations. And then also the showing improved behavior. Well, his behavior's
You can't improve better on his behavior. He's just...
And that's outside of the Oscars. This happened at the Oscars, whereas outside the Oscars, his behavior has generally been impeccable. So he can't come to the Oscars, so we can't prove that he's well-behaved at the Oscars. It's a little bit of a catch-22, I feel like.
And think about some of the people who have come to the Oscars and things that have come, that have happened with them, whether it was drug charges and other things, unsavory things. We won't make any accusations to anyone, but they've been welcome to come to the Oscar and never were banned for their action. Granted, this was at the Oscars.
Right. But he can't prove his good behavior at the Oscars because he can't go.
My question has always been, Will Smith is one of the best actors in the world. And, you know, even the night of the slap heard around the world, he won an Oscar that night, was able to do a speech, was able to apologize and everything. And so, and then the media backlash, and that's when he ended up getting banned. But let's say, granted, Bad Boys 5?
Four.
I gotta get it. And it's my favorite. It's one of my favorite.
You just want more.
Oh, I definitely do. I think this is the last one. But I mean, it's been my years. It's been my favorite series. This Bad Boys 4 is not gonna win an Oscar, but I could totally see Will Smith getting an Oscar again or being eligible for an Oscar.
Being nominated, sure.
What happens when Will Smith comes up and he does the role of a lifetime and he's eligible to be nominated as an Oscar? Do they nominate him and do they allow him to come to the event? Do they say, no, you can't go to the event, but if you win, you can have a family member or a friend go up and accept it on your behalf? Do they roll you up on the stage like Hannibal Lecter to make sure you don't hurt anyone? You know what I mean? You know, do they have them in a cage and they roll them up like Hannibal Lecter? What do they do if Will Smith does something, does a role that makes him eligible to be nominated for an Oscar? And what do they do if he wins? That's the question that I have for you, Miss Sarah.
Well, yeah, it is an interesting question. I mean, even the fact that normally the previous year's winner presents the award to the next year. And you know what? I don't even know who did that. I don't remember.
Oh, no, I didn't know that. Yeah, they just kind of...
I don't know. But as you were talking, I thought...
I can tell you two people who wasn't. I can tell you three people who wasn't. It wasn't Will Smith. It wasn't Chris Rock. And it wasn't Jada Pinkett Smith. It wasn't any of those that was... going up there and nominating or presenting awards to anyone.
I'm looking, I thought, have other people been banned from the Oscars? So apparently you can be banned, which is temporary, and you can be expelled, which is permanent.
Yes.
So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 people have been banned, according to
the... All right, let's see who's the 7 people that's been banned before.
Okay. So this is the person in the year they were banned, Richard Gere, 1993.
What did Richard Gere get banned for?
That's further down. Let's see. He was banned. Give me a second. He was issued a 20-year ban after he gave a speech while he presented the award for Best Art Direction. As Gere addressed the audience, he used his platform to discuss the issues in Tibet. I do remember this. Called out Deng Xiaoping, the leader of the Chinese Communist Party at the time. 20 years, so 19...
Wait, that's extreme, though. 20 years. My man got 20 years for speaking up on injustice?
So then Carmine Caridi, I don't know who that is, 2004. Bill Cosby in 2018.
Wait, what did Bill Cosby do?
Well, you know,
what, he was giving out some Jello pudding pops. That's what he was doing.
Roman Polanski was banned in 2018. Harvey Weinstein was banned in 2017. Adam Kimmel was banned in 2021, and Will Smith in 2022. So,
and none of those guys have ever come back. So they've never. So there isn't a precedent of them ever allowing someone to come back. Richard Gere has never been, as far as I know, in anything Oscar worthy. Nor has Bill Cosby or any of the other ones. Will Smith is the first one who has that opportunity to be to do a role that's worthy of an Oscar nomination.
I am looking to see if any of them have come back to the Oscars, just, you know, to be there. Interesting is that everyone banned from the Oscars, this list is all men.
Mm-hmm. Of course.
So I'm just...
Well, I mean, Richard Gere, 20 years. That one needs to go away. He just spoke up for injustice. 20 years. I mean, it didn't like he went and slapped Sandra Bullock or something like that. He, you know.
I'm just looking to see if anybody's ban was longer than 20 years. So I'm just kind of scrolling through here. This is not something I've ever looked up, to be honest with you.
I'm actually rethinking Will Smith's his sentence now. As much as I love me some Will Smith, for the record, but if Richard Gere got 25 years for speaking out against injustice to the
20 years.
And Will got 10 for slapping Chris Rock, the host, and dropping an F-bomb, keep your out of my wife's name out your no diggity mouth. I think, I'm like, Richard Gere got 20, Will needs 30.
I don't know.
That doesn't make no sense to me.
An equation, some sort of...
How is Richard Gere so much twice as bad as Will Smith slapping Chris Rock? I didn't even realize that. And I don't want Will Smith punished any longer. I want to make sure that is very clear. I just feel like 20 years for Richard Gere may be a little strong. So,
yeah. But we do need to wrap up this segment, so we can finish out the show with our fifth segment. When we come back, we will be talking about the Paris Olympics, which I wish I could go to, because you know what? I could drive to the Paris Olympics. But we're going to talk about that when we come back. You are tuned into the Andrew Tate Show by GSMC Sports, and we will be right back. Welcome back to the Andrew Tate Show by GSMC Sports. In the previous segment, we were talking about Will Smith's ban from the Oscars and the consequences of that, and then we kind of went down a rabbit hole of other people who have been banned.
Richard Gere been banned for 20 years.
And yeah, but moving on, kind of back to sports, although not yeah, it's sports
adjacent.
Sports adjacent, because it is about a sporting event, and that is the Paris Olympics, which of course are
down the street.
The Paris 2024 Olympics, initially heralded for their commitment to sustainability, have encountered significant challenges regarding environmental practices and athlete welfare. Promoted as the greenest games in Olympic history, Paris organizers aim to showcase environmental leadership by reducing carbon emissions, utilizing sustainable materials in construction, and promoting plant-based catering. Central to this vision was the Olympic Village, originally designed without air conditioning, relying instead on a geothermal cooling system, using groundwater to maintain cooler temperatures indoors. However, as summer approaches and forecasts predict higher than average temperatures across France, concerns about athlete safety and performance have emerged. Athletes, teams, and delegations voiced apprehension about the potential health risks of competing in extreme heat, including heat stroke and dehydration. Responding to these concerns, Paris 2024 organizers decided to allow national teams to install portable air conditioning units at their own expense. This decision comes despite the initial commitment to eschew traditional air conditioning, which is known for its high energy consumption and environmental impact. The compromise underscores the delicate balance between sustainability goals and the immediate needs of athletes. While the introduction of air conditioning units aims to ensure athlete comfort and safety during the competition, it represents a setback in achieving the ambitious carbon reduction target set forth by the Paris agreements, to which France is a signatory. In addition to the air conditioning controversy, other environmental challenges have surfaced. Plans to host swimming events in the Seine River were thwarted due to high levels of fecal bacteria, which was not a story we talked about, raising questions about...
I was going to say, can I didn't mean to cut you off on that one. Okay. They were going to do swimming events in the river. Someone created an app where you could figure out the was it the prime minister or someone was going to be
swimming. Prime minister and I think mayor of Paris.
They were going to swim in the river. They created an app with an algorithm that could tell people when they could use the restroom so that they could maximize the amount of...
You're being too kind. It was called poop in the Seine.
Yeah, so that when they swim across it, they would get extra excrement. It
flow downstream to on the appropriate day of their...
On the exact time. So they were actually timing it so
that people could... during our break, and we were going to talk about that.
Yeah, so it's been... And here's the thing. France has this really strong push for a greener economy, a greener world. Europe has a very big push for a greener economy and greener world. And so they're trying to make this the greenest Olympics of all times. My thing, and I know I cut you off and didn't let you really finish.
It was wrapping up. I mean,
right. So here's the thing though. With them, it's they're experiencing this outrageous heat. And so they're compromising and they're saying you can bring your own individual air conditioned unit at your own expense. But if you're talking about a greener footprint, those individual air conditioned units are way worse for the environment than if they would have just put in a centralized air conditioned unit for each building. I think it's not going to, it doesn't seem like it's going to turn out quite the way everyone had hoped it to be. Do you see where I'm coming from with that one? What are your thoughts on this, Sarah?
I appreciate the effort to make it the greenest Olympics ever. I think that is a really good goal, and especially on such a worldwide stage and such an event that gains so much attention. But in terms of athlete safety, there definitely needs to be some compromise and some figuring things out. Where's the balance between demonstrating your commitment to environmental issues and athlete safety, because it is, again, a very global event, and you do not need athletes getting sick, getting injured, and dying of heat stroke if you want to go to the extreme. That's not going to be a good image either.
Well, and I think what they could do, I mean, that's an easy fix. Number one, if they're having record-breaking heat, you may have to kind of reschedule events later on in the day, later on, you know, instead of running, you know, the marathon in the middle of the day, maybe you're running it late afternoon or early in the morning. You can still time things so that safety can be, you know, taken care of. Does that make sense?
Yeah, Well, and hopefully they do that in the first place, because this is the Summer Olympics. They take place in July and August. No matter where you are, there's going to be heat concerns, unless you're somewhere that's really, really cold.
But, you know, here's the thing. I know everyone's talking about heat concerns. And for all our American listeners, I know America, lived there my whole life. The heat you guys are having right now, it's not. It's way worse than what we're having here in Europe. I mean, way worse. You know, I just saw, was it Nevada set a record
Las
again?
Las Vegas hit 120, the highest.
California, where we're from, just smoltering.
And then
plus, we're not getting that kind of weather here in Europe. The difference is,
we don't have ice.
Right, yeah. The difference is there's a lot of people in the UK and Norway and Sweden, Finland, Germany. They're not used to really high temperatures. So a 90 degree day in Europe is like 110, 120 in California. They're just not used to it. That's all it comes down to. People, we come out, we do our walk, we do a lot of things. Sarah and I, production, instead of doing a production meeting and off, we just do a long walk. And people, they're not used to being out in the heat like we are. So it's more about being adjusted to it. I think, one, most Americans will be able to adopt. A lot of people in a lot of warmer climates, they won't look at it as that bad. But some of the northern European countries, it's roasting to them. They're not used to that. And then, like Sarah said, we don't have ice. We have ice. Hardest adjustment of all as an American moving to Europe is you're used to getting that big, you know, you sit down at a restaurant, they give you a big old glass with ice water and everything, crushed ice, all that stuff. You don't get that here. I was like, when I order a drink, I'm always like, I would like, let's say I do Coke Zero. I want a Coke Zero. I want extra ice. And then I want a cup of ice. That'll give me about 4 cubes.
I actually proposed to a waiter last summer when he brought an extra glass of ice that actually had like 10 ice cubes.
Yeah, they don't believe in bringing the ice to the table. That is such an American thing, is ice in there. And they find it weird. But then I also find it weird when, you know, it's the middle of the summer and they're ordering hot tea and coffee. It makes no sense to me. So on that one.
All right. Well, it'll be interesting to see how things go, and which I know a number of teams have opted into paying for their own AC. So it'll be interesting to see if more countries decide as well. And I love the Olympics anyway, so we'll be talking more about the Olympics.
It is so close.
Yes. So thank you for tuning in to the Andrew Tate Show by GSMC Sports. Your support means a lot to us always. So make sure you like, follow, subscribe. That really does help the algorithm. Also, leave a positive review. That helps more than you can possibly know, and we appreciate it very much. You can follow the podcast on social media, Facebook, X, Instagram, and TikTok. Come find us on social media, and we love hearing from you. We hope you're having a great day. Thank you so much for joining us.
Peace.
Let's go. I wake up to a little bit of drool on my pillow, feel like it's gonna be a bad day. Yeah, I'm tired of shit, and the coffee ain't hit yet. Damn, ain't that great. I don't wanna go to